Like that, you see?
Okay.
Solid through solid.
Okay, solid.
Now, I have here a pocket handkerchief, which I will place into her hand like that. See, that's to catch the drippings. And now, blade number two. Watch.
Impossible?
Right through, just like that.
And you're...
Two blades of steel right through her, right through the cabinet.
Push it there, you see, it goes all the way through there.
Right there. There, David, you see, not cut in half, but cut into three sections right before your eyes.
How do you do it?
Rather carefully. Yes, but
you okay?
See, of course she's fine, but in case there are those who don't believe that she's actually cut into three sections.
I don't believe it.
You don't?
No.
Let me show you something else.
All right.
Watch this. And as you can see, there she is divided into three sections. And notice the fingers, the toes, the smile, still there.
Harry, I think you've cut a nerve.
What's the matter?
I can't feel my hanky.
You can't feel your hanky? Oh, no, excuse me. No, it's all right. It's all right. She just dropped the hanky on the floor. It's all right, dear. You feel that?
Yes.
It's all right. There it is. David, I'd like you to take this yourself.
Thank
and
you.
You can verify. You touch the fingers.
Right. Yeah.
There.
Yeah.
Touch the other hand over
right.
here.
Right.
And the toes.
Tickle, tickle.
In fact, would you place the handkerchief back into her hand?
Yes, I shall.
Thank
and there, you felt all the parts.
Harry, that's...
Oh, wait a minute. There's one part you didn't feel.
Sir.
That's over here. You might want to feel this part as well. You might touch your tummy right there, and you can feel her breathing. Can you feel it?
Yes, I can.
Of course you can. Hope you don't become emotionally involved.
I must tell you, I am standing right here, and
it's
I
impossible.
Have no idea. Yes, it is impossible.
Now, the tough part is putting her back together again.
Yes. How do you do that, Harry? By golly.
Like this, and right through here. Right here. Just like that. There's the handkerchief. There she is. And now, we let her out, and hopefully she's as good as new.
Oh,
by golly,
that
she
incredible.
Is.
Oh,
how about
that's
that?
Fabulous.
Thank you.
Very well done, my dear.
Thank you.
Jay, thank you.
Thank you, David,
thank you.
So much for
wonderful.
The opportunity to be here and to say good morning to you and to America.
Everybody, thank you. Pat Collins is going to come in and join us right
I'm
now.
Glad to see you're in one piece.
You bet. We're fine.
We deal with Pat now.
What? Sure, Pat, would you like to get in
the
car?
No, you didn't tell me I had
no,
to
this is a surprise
Pat,
for you.
When you're working
inside.
Live television, Pat, so you have to understand.
Okay, goodbye.
Put your toe right outside the front.
All right.
Toe right outside the door, just like that, through the little hole right there.
Right through the hole. Might be you're too big. All right.
One hand right here.
All right.
And right there.
That's right. 12 minutes up right now. Magic and the world of illusion have been a way of life for Harry Blackstone Jr. His father was the great Blackstone, one of the most talented magicians of all times. And Harry Blackstone Jr. has inherited, in a sense, his father's bag of tricks. Bag of trade, a little pun there. Recently, he has put together a 110-city cross-country tour, including their 29-person entourage of singers and dancers and musicians, and he's the magician, not to mention some doves and rabbits and tigers and donkeys and an elephant. And good morning, Harry.
Good morning.
Elephant?
Yes, and you even forgot the canary.
I'm sorry.
Which I brought along. It's the only one that would travel over here.
Cup.
You see, I forgot to. Well, anyway, good morning.
I don't know how you did that.
Well, I thought rather well.
What? You did it?
Yes.
Brilliantly, but I don't. You don't really need lots of... I mean, obviously, you don't.
As David mentioned earlier, all the magic throughout the entire hour is being done without any camera tricks. You're seeing it at home just as it was performed in the...
Good evening. I'm Bill Bixby. As an actor, I played the part of a magician, and I've dabbled in magic personally. I bow to no one in my enthusiasm for the art of magic. And that's why it's a special pleasure for me to present one of the true masters of that art. What we'll see tonight, without benefit of any camera tricks, is the result of a year's careful creation, preparation, and practice designed to bring us the epitome of the mystery of magic. Dramatic illusions which have never before been performed on television. Here now, in a triumph of both talent and style, magic of David Copperfield.
Mm-hmm.
Magic of David Copperfield, sponsored by Nestle Crunch.
Good evening, and welcome to An Hour of Illusion. My name is David Copperfield. The first magic to have ever fascinated me wasn't only the Houdini kind, but also...
The mysteries of the East are not just fables or legends. They are a tangible and real presence. To the very air you breathe, the feeling is pure magic. And who better to guide us through this magical country than the greatest magician in the world today, David Copperfield. He stunned millions when he vanished a jet airplane and made the Statue of Liberty disappear. Now, you might be wondering what challenge the Far East has in store for David. Well, we're standing on it. For centuries, this wall has warded off invasions by the world's most formidable armies. Yet, tonight, in front of a live audience, without the aid of video trickery, David is going to attempt to walk through the Great Wall of China. Impossible, you say? Perhaps not, for the magic of David Copperfield.
Annual Magic of David Copperfield is sponsored by The 8th Annual Magic of David Copperfield is sponsored by...
I'm David Copperfield, and welcome to our journey to China. For the past 2 years, I've been preparing for my attempt to walk through the Great Wall. We've brought a plane load of brand new illusions halfway around the globe to combine the finest mysteries in the world of magic with the magic and majesty that is China. From here, the Temple of Heaven, to the mysteries of the Forbidden City, from the serenity of Beihai Park, to the crowds at Tiananmen Square. But what you'll see aren't just the monuments of China. As breathtaking and as awesome as this country is, its true wonder lies in its people. Tonight, we're going to share 3 weeks of incredible experiences in a country with a population of over 1 billion. And it's going to be my pleasure to introduce you to some of them.
For a traveler in China, it seems that every corner you turn reveals a new adventure, more mysterious and wonderful than the last. Well, had you been walking through the streets of Beijing a few nights ago, you would have not only marveled at the ancient wonders of China, you would have witnessed one of the newest wonders of the magic of David Copperfield. He calls it seeing through a woman.
Tonight's attempt to walk through the Great Wall. We had many exciting experiences in China. One of them was having the chance to perform for my friends from the American Embassy.
Now comes the the part of the show where usually I do a levitation, you see. Normally a little Gershwin music plays, a little romance, and I levitate one of my assistants. I thought tonight it might be really great if I tried to levitate somebody from the audience. I need to find a lady in the audience who's had a fantasy. A levitate. Any woman who's had a flying dream, a dream you fly like Superman, raise your hand. I need to find a female to float. Put your hand down, sir. All the husbands are pointing to their wives. Really? Come on. Give her a big hand as she comes up here on stage. Hello! What's your name?
Erin.
Erin, you raised your hand. You've had a fantasy about flying.
Yes.
You ever have flying dreams?
Yes.
You know what that means, don't you?
No.
That means you have a secret desire to date a magician. Erin, are you chewing gum?
Yes.
Did you bring enough for the whole class? She actually put the gum in my hand. Here. Gonna save it for later. Stand over here, Erin. If I'm gonna levitate you, we're gonna have to build a makeshift couch for you to lie down on. Hold on to this. Got a couple of step ladders. Comfy. Little finesse. Very little finesse. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I think it's only fair that if Erin here gets to fulfill her fantasy, I think it's only fair that I should get to fulfill my fantasy. My fantasy is to levitate Erin here while I sing like Frank Sinatra. And I can do that because Mr. Sinatra and I, well, Frank and I, we're like this. I'm the one over here. Hit it.
Come fly with me, we'll fly. You can use some exotic booze. There's a bar in far Bombay. Come on, fly with me. We'll fly away. Come fly with me. We'll float down to Peru. In Llama Land, there's a one-man band, and he'll toot his flute for you. Come on, fly with me. We'll float down in the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide, starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near, you might hear all the angels cheer, because we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a lovely day. Just say those words, we'll beat those birds down to Acapulco Bay. It is perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. Come on, fly with me, we'll fly, we'll fly. Absolutely petrified. fire. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so awfully near. You might even hear a gang of angels cheer just because we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a groovy day. You just say that word and I'll beat your bird down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, now they do say. Come on, fly with me, we'll fly, we'll fly. Pack up, let's fly away.
For the ballad. Let's move on.
Aaron? Aaron, I was just, we didn't rehearse that, did we? How did it feel?
Fantastic.
Thank you, Aaron. Time to borrow some. No, perfect, perfect. Ma'am, may I borrow your handbag? Do you mind? I promise not to look through it. I promise not to look through it. Let's see what she's got. Wow. You are organized. You got your keys here and your handy notes. Did you get this on TV? KTEL? The reason I borrow this is my favorite TV show is just about to begin. And on yesterday's show, they said to get some items from around the house so we could all learn how to do a new magic trick. Now, we were able to patch into the satellite from American television so we could all learn the trick by listening to the sound from the TV. It's my favorite show, and it's about to begin right now.
It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood. A beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's the neighborly day in this neighborhood. A beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? I've always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you. So let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say,
would you be mine? Could you be mine? Won't you be Jim neighbors?
Sing, please, everybody.
Won't you please, everybody, sing. Please, won't you be my
neighbor? My neighbor?
Today, we're going to learn some magic. We're going to make a bandana disappear. Can you say bandana?
Bandana!
I knew you could. First, take out a bandana. Fold it in half. That's right. Fold it in half. Now, fold it one more time. Take the folded bandana and secretly hide it in your left hand. Keep your hand in a natural position. This is known as palming. Now that you've perfected palming, we're ready to begin. Open up the folded bandana. Greet the audience by waving it up and down. To prove it's a real bandana, ask an audience member to wipe their face with it. Or blow their nose in it. take out your mother's favorite handbag. Place the bandana in the handbag. Close the bag firmly around the bandana. What the audience doesn't know is that you never put the bandana in the bag at all. You kept it hidden in your left palm. Remember palming? I knew you would. Remember to keep your hand in a natural position. Make a magical gesture over the handbag. And with a grand flourish, fling the bag open and wait for your well-deserved response.
From the moment they were born to the moment they died, most of the workers who built the Great Wall of China knew no other life. Some were even buried within the very wall that dominated their lives. Tonight, they're about to receive a visitor as David Copperfield attempts to walk through the Great Wall of China.
The language, you're going to need a way to communicate. Some things are very easy to understand, though. Magic, like music, is a universal language. You share a secret, trade a smile, and you make a new friend.
Beginnings of magic can be traced back to ancient China. So I was very fortunate to have the chance to visit and exchange ideas with some of Beijing's most accomplished magicians. Magic is not only an entertainment to these people, it's a tradition that has been handed down from generation to generation. After the show, we got a chance to exchange some secrets between the East and the West. Since most Chinese magicians have been trained as acrobats and dancers, great attention is paid to their physical style and dexterity. So they were very quick to try the new effects I shared with them.
Ah, good. Again.
Even though we didn't speak the same language, we were able to communicate through a dedication we shared through our craft.
Yes, and good. Very good.
Before I came to China, I prepared an illusion especially for them. Using a chopstick and an American quarter, I showed them something I thought would be totally new.
Yeah.
those who built it to the armies that tried to penetrate it. The Great Wall has been a challenge that has cost many their lives. Tonight, the challenge continues. Without the aid of camera tricks or electronic gimmicks, David Copperfield is going to try to walk through the Great Wall of China.
Over 2 years of research and planning have gone into tonight's attempt. The Illusions began the journey to China early last summer, followed by David and his staff. Over 70,000 pounds of equipment were transported halfway around the world.
David's attempt to walk through the wall will not only be one of the greatest illusions in the history of magic, he's hoping to symbolize that no barriers are insurmountable. The bond that develops in the spirit of friendship is a bond that no wall can come between. Please stay with us. In 400 BC, construction was begun on a wall to ward off the invaders from the north. Its success soon prompted other walls to spring up along the countryside until finally, they were connected and fortified by the Ming emperors to become the Great Wall we know today. Since its beginning, it has served as an impenetrable barrier to countless armies. Even an assault made by Genghis Khan, the world's greatest conqueror, was a failure. Tonight, you're going to witness a very different attempt. David Copperfield is going to try and walk through the Great Wall of China.
The Great Wall stretches from the ocean beaches in the east to the impassable mountains of the west. Its tremendous length of over 2,500 miles is roughly the distance from one coast of the United States to the other. It stands 30 feet high, and at its base is 25 feet thick. The wall's immense size makes it the only man-made object visible from the moon. I've been joined by a Chinese translator, and we're here with Mr. Gao Jinhua, one of the members of the Great Wall Committee. Sir, you've examined the site. Are there any holes or openings in the wall?
高先生，您了解这八达岭的情况？你认为墙这边能不能从墙这边穿过去呢？
根本不可能，绝对不可能。
No, the wall is completely solid.
Do you see any way that David can walk through this wall?
你认为David先生有没有办法从墙这边穿过去啊？
那太不可能。
Absolutely not.
Now, we all know it's impossible to walk through walls, and I felt the same way until I heard about this monastery in Tibet. They found the bones of a man embedded in a wall. His entire skeleton was stuck, trapped inside the wall, running in and out of each brick. The only explanation they could think of was that a monk had discovered a form of meditation that allowed him to pass through objects. Experts aren't sure whether he did this often or whether it was his first attempt. One thing for sure, it was his last. Scientifically speaking, what that monk did wasn't walk through the wall. He diffused through it. The McGraw-Hill Encyclopedia of Science and Technology defines diffusion as the actual transport of mass in the form of discrete atoms through a solid. It's very easy to understand. Take an ice cube and a piece of cardboard. Both are solids. But if that ice cube should become hot, it would change its state to water. Then it can join with and eventually pass through that piece of cardboard. Then it can refreeze on the other side.
We'll be able to track David visually through the use of this remote-controlled camera. Cutting to another camera, we'll be able to see David enter one side of the wall, and in a continuous motion, the camera will move over the top of the wall and hopefully see him emerge from the other side.
placing electrodes on David's chest. They are connected to a transmitter on his body. Receiving dishes have been strategically placed to pick up David's heartbeat. The signal will then be displayed on this EKG monitor. That way, we'll be able to see if there's any increase or decrease in David's heart rate as he progresses through the wall. I'd like to remind you that David uses absolutely no camera tricks. The illusion you're about to see at home is exactly the way you'd see it if you were here with our live audience in China. Ladies and gentlemen, the magic of David Copperfield.
to thank my host, Ben Vereen, the folks at Kraft, and the people of China for making us feel so welcome. We hope this will be the first of many magical journeys around the world. Next year, Egypt. And I've got the transportation right here. Good night, everybody.
Annual Magic of David Copperfield has been sponsored by
the hour. The mysterious Orient has always been fascinating to us Westerners. It seems, though, that one of the most puzzling mysteries of the Orient just now is actually the work of a young magician from the United States. He is David Copperfield. His next television special on March 14th will feature his trip to China, where, believe it or not, he walked straight through the Great Wall of China. Now, I gather you made it to the other side since you were joining us this morning. Good morning,
David. Yes, hello. Good to be here.
What a remarkable feat. Now, you see, when we hear about something like walking through the Great Wall, or as you have done in the past, making a jet disappear, or making the Statue of Liberty disappear, we think, got to be some video tricks, something like that. Not true, huh?
No, not at all. In fact, on this walking through the Great Wall, we brought a special remote control camera that sees me going in one side of the wall and then cranes over the top of the wall and sees me coming out of the other side all in one shot in front of a live audience there.
So there are people gathered watching both sides of the wall.
Thousands, yes.
It's an astonishing thing. You went to China and persuaded the government to do this. Now, how in the world did you pull that off?
Well, it's making red tape disappear. Literally red tape.
Diligently.
Yes. But we did it. We kind of did it to show that there was no boundaries between our countries, you know, and the fact that there are no barriers between friends. I could walk through this object that was created to keep armies out. And it was quite a trip. We spent a month there.
We all are interested in China. I would love to go to China. Have not. So you went. We got some pictures of it. Tell us what you found when you went to that country.
Well, we got to shoot in many, many different places. This is the Temple of Heaven over here, and we brought 70,000 pounds of illusions and equipment and lighting and so forth over there. And we were allowed to shoot in places that haven't really been shot before. That's Tiananmen Square. I think that's pretty familiar to everybody.
Now, weren't they a little bit nervous about it? Look at this. Holy cow.
Floating a young Chinese lad. They were wonderful to work with. It was kind of a cultural collaboration between our countries and introducing a lot of brand new illusions over there and really showing it. You know, we spent a lot of time shooting all the different locations and illusions. Of course, is the Great Wall of China where the big illusion took place.
Do you have to sit and figure out how you're going to pull something off like this? It seems like a terrible puzzle that you have to work on for a while, huh?
Yeah, well, I've been rehearsing this on the road. We're currently on a tour all over the United States, playing every city you can imagine. And this is an illusion I do with a steel wall on stage. You know, currently every night we do it. But doing it at the Great Wall was very, very exciting and really quite challenging.
There are a lot of people that are involved in a trick like this.
Yes.
Let's say an illusion like this.
Right.
You have to swear everybody to secrecy.
That's right. We have all of the crew who are involved and might see how things are done assign secrecy agreements, promising they won't tell how.
Has it ever leaked out?
Well, once, when we made the airplane disappear, a cameraman told his wife you know, figured it was okay. And the wife had a friend that called in a radio call-in show and told exactly how the airplane illusion was done. But luckily, the method was so ridiculous that nobody really believed her.
Now, see, you've always been interested in magic from a very, very young age, and other magicians seem to have started at a young age, too. Is there something that you find a common thread that runs through people?
Well, I think I really wanted acceptance from other kids and so forth, and I really wasn't athletic or very into sports, and magic really helped me with my communication skills, just like you just saw right now. That's really, I think, why magic appeals to so many young people.
You are working on something that's very special called Project Magic.
Yes, Project Magic is a program that uses magic as a form of therapy for people with disabilities, where magicians actually go into hospitals and teach magic to patients to help them regain their dexterity and their coordination by learning sleight of hand, in addition to boosting their self-esteem by giving the disabled person a skill that an able-bodied person doesn't even have. Mm-hmm. And, for example, I don't know if you can get... Oh, that's pretty tight enough. You can see the rubber bands around these two fingers over here, and if I pass my hand over,
holy
I'll jump
cow.
To those two fingers over there.
Can now, you do that one more time?
Yeah. The thing is that will motivate someone to open and close their hand when if they've had a stroke or if they've had arthritis. Uh-huh. Magicians work with occupational therapists and teach the this is a version, by the way, uh-huh. where you can actually lock it on like this, so
right.
It's actually
so
trapped.
No way it can jump across.
So there's no way, but if you pass your hand over, it'll jump like that. Anyway.
That's absolutely astonishing. Now, the people that you work with are able to pick these up?
Yes, they try very, very hard, and they work gradually at it, and hopefully it's a transitional tool to get them to learn how to dress again, you know, if they've had trouble with a stroke or arthritis, this type of thing. And it's in 30 countries and 500 hospitals around the world.
So it's really a way of showing them that they can accomplish things if they put their minds to it.
Absolutely.
David Copperfield's special is on
March 14th. We're currently on the road all over the United States.
And we're always inventing new illusions. In fact, the illusion we're going to do in the show in a few minutes is an original illusion. We try to think of something completely impossible that nobody's ever seen before.
A lot of your things seem to be completely impossible.
I hope so.
A lot of the, you know, illusions that we've seen on television, a lot of people say, gosh, that's just not magic. It's the magic of television that actually does that. Has television been a help to your craft or actually been a...
Well, it's been a great help because just imagine in one of our television shows, more people see me than saw Houdini in his whole lifetime. So it's very important to spread the magic. But also you have to be very careful that people don't expect trick photography and think it is. So I always try to do my shows in front of a live audience or do live shows. Like, this is a live show, so nobody can kind of gimmick the tape or anything like that.
Right, and you're going to show us an illusion that's never been seen before, right?
Right.
Okay, show me this.
It's kind
now.
Of a variation of a wonderful thing. You'd like to see
okay,
it?
Okay, yeah, I'm going to try
okay.
to figure it out.
Oh, you don't try to figure out, you just try to feel the wonder. That's
oh,
the
okay.
great thing. I once had a very magical dream. I dreamt that my wife, Debbie, and I had a little magic shop. And so we built a little model of the magic shop, and I wanted to show you here today and show Maria and Forrest. Now, as you can see, the magic shop is completely empty. I'm just going to turn it around here. Now, this magic shop is unlike any magic shop in the world, in that kids come to this magic shop, and there's absolutely nothing for sale. All they come to is to learn all about the magic of nature. Now, if you're a magician, you can do an illusion with a magic shop such as this. Look, a beautiful flower. We just put it down here inside of the box. I close the door, and look. Hundreds of flowers. The little magic shop allows a magician to make objects like flowers multiply. There we go. Now, if I can pick the most beautiful flower, as well as multiplying objects, I can take the flower and put it in there. Here we go. We just close the back door. And look, a little magical spin. Now, it's my wife, Debbie. How did you get in there?
Let her out.
There's hardly room for
look
her in
that.
There.
That is wonderful.
Bravo. Welcome, Debbie. How are you going to get down it? Let's just see if we can do something for you here.
How did you do that?
Whoa! Very carefully.
So stay stop anytime you'd like.
Okay.
Okay. I can even give him some fancy cuts like this.
Stop.
Okay, right there. Now we obviously have a random selection at this point. It's the five of diamonds. Five of diamonds. Of course, all I have to do with the five of diamonds is snap it four times, once for each spot. and it becomes the ace of diamonds, but they could be thinking, I just got lucky. So here's what I'll do, here's what I'll do.
Okay.
I'll dribble the cards like this. Anytime you'd like, just say, stop dribbling.
Okay. Stop dribbling!
Okay, that's not very many. Is that enough?
That's plenty.
Okay, this time you've stopped me at the ace of clubs. Now, that's two aces out of four. The third one, I'll kind of do it myself. It's a little quicker that way. All I have to do is cut like this, and one comes out from the center. That is the ace of hearts. That's three out of four, but ace number four, I'll find it the fancy way, at the count of three. There you go. One, two, three. Yeah, there you go.
Michael! That is super!
Do you know what I'd like to do? You know, in the world competition, it's an interesting challenge because you're judged by your peers, and technique plays a real important role. So I designed a challenge-type effect. I want to tell everybody what I want to do. This will involve no surprises whatsoever. I'll tell you what I'm going to do, and that way, if I don't do it, it's going to be blatant to everyone.
Okay.
Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to take these four aces, and I'm going to put them into four different parts of this deck. Then I want to shuffle these cards five times, face up into face down. Then I'll find those same four aces again. But I'll do the entire process. That includes the insertions, the shuffles, and the locations, all in exactly 30 seconds. Would you happen to have a second hand on your watch, Merv?
Yeah.
Okay, now, you're the times person, so you need to tell me as every 5 seconds passes, simply say 5, 10, 15, 20. It lets me know whether I'm ahead or behind.
Okay.
And I may
stop. Don't go till I start to you.
Okay.
Go.
Okay, there's the ace of clubs, the ace of hearts, the ace of spades, the ace of diamonds. That's one, two, three, four aces, four different parts of the deck.
5 seconds.
Now push them flush. I'll take half the cards and shuffle them face up into face down.
10.
Just like this. Take some of those cards, turn them over, and shuffle them face up into face down one more time. I can even take some out from the
15.
Very center of the deck, turn them all over just like this, and shuffle them one more time face up into face
20.
Down. 20. Oh, I better shut up. And shuffle. Oh.
25.
Oh, stop.
30.
How much time was left when I said stop?
1 second.
Well, it's perfect. I haven't found the aces yet.
Ah.
But I guess you knew that.
Yeah.
Now, the reason I didn't, see, you've got a great seat, and some of these people can see real well. But there's people at home who haven't followed quite as well as you have. So here's what I want to do. I stopped early for a reason. See, I stopped so that I could show that the cards really are being shuffled face up and face down. And you can look from the sides to see that all the cards are involved in the shuffle. I mean, these aren't TV magic shuffles or anything like that.
Yeah.
So all the cards are involved in the shuffle. And I said that I would do it all in exactly 30 seconds, and that was a real important part of this. So I'm going to start, let's say 29 seconds.
Okay, you have 1 second?
I have 1 second to find all four aces. I hope this works.
I do, too.
Okay, I'll start again. 28, 29, 30. Whoops, 1, 2, 3, 4. There's all...
Gee, look at that.
Not only that, but the deck that we shuffled face up and face down, it all faces exactly the same way, each and every card. And if you'll look close, you'll see that all the cards, every single card, is facing the same way, and there's no aces. I found the only four aces, and in that same one half of 1 minute, the 30 seconds, not only did I find those four, but I also found the Royal Flushing Clubs. That's the 10, Jack, Queen, King, Ace of Clubs, a Royal Flushing Spades, Royal Flushing Hearts, and a Royal Flushing Clubs.
No!
It's all four.
Maybe you'd like to... I'm going down to Vegas this evening. Maybe
can we
like,
go?
Sure. Love to have you come along.
You think they'll let me take my own deck?
Never.
Well, I guess we don't need these anymore, so yeah. We'll get rid of those.
Is that it?
Good, Ernie Borgnine worked with me and say, now, Debbie, don't be upset. Just play the scene naturally. Don't let him get to you. And, well, we lived through it somehow. But he was the only one that was ever really mean to me.
This is the Statue of Liberty. Tonight, the illusion of the century. David Copperfield will attempt to make the Statue of Liberty disappear.
Mr.
Good evening. I'm David Copperfield. And tonight we're here on Liberty Island. People come to this island by boat, and I've made the trip quite frequently during this past year, getting ready for tonight. A couple of weeks ago when I was on the boat, a young sightseer about 7 years old came up to me and said, "Are you David?" He said he saw me make a car disappear. And then he said he saw me make the jet plane disappear. I thanked him, and I watched as he looked up at the Statue of Liberty, then at me, then back to the statue, then back to me. Finally, he looked me right in the eye and said, "Are you thinking what I think you're thinking?" Well, that's what I was thinking, all right. And tonight, he and I and you are going to find out if it can be done. Can the Statue of Liberty really disappear? Well, one thing's for sure. It won't be done with camera tricks. All the magic you'll see on your television screen tonight
is what you could see if you were right here or part of live audience.
For example, right now let's go on a little magical journey. To where? Well, you'll find out.
Magic of David Copperfield, sponsored by Pillsbury, makers of hot, fresh slice-and-bake cookies, and new Special K, now with bigger, crispier flakes, still high in protein, low in sugar.
Kellogg's Special K has a brand new look, just for you.
A bigger flake, a crisp-like taste, made for today. Take to the K, new Kellogg's Special K.
Introducing new improved Special K cereal. The flakes are bigger, crispier, high in protein, low in sugar, and even better part of your low-calorie Special K breakfast.
Tastes great, first rate, for your life today. Take to the K, new Kellogg's Special K.
Okay.
What do you want for a snack?
Cookies. Ice cream, cookies, ice cream.
Why not put Pillsbury slice and bake cookies and ice cream together and make cookie ice cream arounds? First, bake up the cookies, then let them cool. Put ice cream in between, and you've got cookie ice cream arounds.
Great! Fantastic! Great! Fantastic!
You can make magic, you know.
Everyone likes Pillsbury cookie ice cream arounds.
With the magic of hot and fresh dough.
It's really terrific to have so many people here with me on this special night. Well, you've just seen the Statue of Liberty. And I had to go and tell everybody I was going to make it disappear. Have you been there? The statue is incredibly big. A little bigger than it was in the postcard. But before we get to that, I'll need someone to help me take my mind off my worries. And I know the perfect person. From the hit comedy show, SCTV, here's Eugene Levy.
David, sweetheart, you know, as an entertainer, I just couldn't pass up the chance to be in on this overhyped bit with the pencil sharpener.
pencil sharpener.
David, come on, I'm a comic. Please, give me credit. I can see right through a concept, the bit, the gag. I can see right through to the punchline, the blow, the payoff.
What are you talking about?
Well, it says here you're going to make the Statue of Liberty disappear, right? Well, I happen to know that what you're going to make disappear is this Statue of Liberty pencil sharpener, because it's a lot easier. Am I right, huh?
Eugene, haven't you read this? We're talking about the real Statue of Liberty. You know, the one in New York Harbor. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses.
There's no pencil sharpener?
No pencil sharpener.
Well, I'm disappointed. I'd be less than honest with you, David, if I said I wasn't disappointed because I thought I figured this thing out. But it doesn't matter, because I'll tell you, the reason I'm on the show, no offense, is Morgan Fairchild. She's a very sexy lady, and I'm going to ask her out.
Did you say something? No. No, did you say something?
Yes, I said I'm going to ask Morgan Fairchild out on a date.
Oh, you don't want to do that.
I don't?
No, Eugene, you're a man of the world. Oh. You've got style. You've got class. You've got panache.
I don't like that kind of talk.
Panache is good, Gene.
Oh, it is. Well, that's good.
Besides, that type of thing is beneath you. You follow me, don't you?
No, I don't.
Well, I just think it would be imposing.
Well, you're not imposing on me, David, because how else is she going to get a chance to meet me? And I'll tell you something. Once she meets me, the date is in the bag.
Bag? In the bag? There's an idea. Eugene, you are my guest. Morgan will be here any minute, and if I can't make the magic happen, well, who can?
David, you rascal. Now you're cooking with gas. I like.
Okay. Get in the bag.
Okay. Now, this, I'm not used to this kind of thing, you know. So, if I'm not, what are you doing here? Gift wrapping me for Morgan or something?
Something.
I get it. You're going to help me get in a little sack time.
That's good.
Am I safe in here?
It's the best place for you. Trust me. Goes to show you. One day you're a big comic, the next day... Oh, here she is. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Morgan Fairchild.
Hi, David.
How are you?
Oh, I'm so excited to be working with you on the show.
Oh, really?
Uh-huh.
Morgan, I was just wondering, maybe after the show, you and I might be able to perhaps...
David, what have you got behind your back?
Well, nothing. Why would I have anything behind my back?
Oh, hey, is this that article on the Statue of Liberty everybody was talking about?
Yes, it is. Morgan, I was just wondering, maybe, after the show.
Do you mind if I do it?
Well, go right ahead.
David, this is going to be terrific. David.
Nice shoes. What do they call this type of shoe material?
Leather.
Leather.
What are you doing?
Knees. Nice knees. And they hold up your legs so well.
Oh,
thought maybe after the show, we could,
David, what have you got in there? You know, you're my very favorite. You know, there's just something about comedians that's so sexy.
Kevin Fairchild and Eugene Levy.
How you doing?
Not too bad.
Not too bad. Do you play cards?
Yes, I do.
You do? I just happen to have a deck of cards right here. Could you examine them closely for me? That's close enough. Thank you very much. I'm just kidding. Here, just take a good look at those cards. Make sure they're not unusual or nothing's funny about them. You've all heard of marked cards. Yes? Yeah. That's where you can tell one card from the other by little markings on the back. Well, those cards aren't marked, are they?
Nope.
No, they look perfectly, and they are perfectly normal. But I'm going to show you the newest methods of marking cards. We'll be able to tell these three cards from the rest of the deck by the newest methods of marking cards. The first method is called the gambler's crimp. It's a method of putting a little tiny bend in the back of the cards. Here we go. The gambler's crimp, almost impossible to see. Now, of course, you need special glasses to see this bend. Believe me, there's a bend in the card. The next method is called the invisible notch. It's a method of putting a little tiny notch in these cards. Here we go, the invisible notch. Almost impossible to see. Now, if you read Braille, you can feel the difference. These cards. Here we go. The final method is called the Las Vegas link. It's a method of marking two cards with one by invisibly linking it on the other two. It looks something like this. Unlink them by making a wish and blow it. One more time, just for fun. Or you can unlink them by ripping them, just like that. Or go back in time in 10 seconds. Three restored cards.
Come on, make sure they're restored. Are they back together?
More magic with David Copperfield. But first, a magic moment from McDonald's.
I remember when little sister, you were two, I was 10. Baby sister, you tried desperately for attention from me. Would you settle for a French fry for now, little baby sister of mine?
You grew up together, McDonald's and you grew and you grew and you grew.
Just a me too, tag along, tomboy making a scene. Then I turned around and found a homecoming queen. Little sister, you know I'm gonna miss her, 'cause we grew up together,
McDonald's and you.
You can brighten up a rainy day with the music of Nestle Crunch.
Crunch.
creamy milk chocolate is the melody.
Chocolatey, good, good, good.
Crispy crunchies are the harmony.
Crunchy, crunch, crunch, crunch.
The two together are music to munch.
I like to take a big bite of the Nestle Crunch.
Bright and lively tickles your tongue.
I like to sink my teeth into some.
Brighten up with music. Nestle Crunch is music
to your mouth.
Sunday on Goodnight Beantown, will Jenny be seduced by Matt's famous friend Lucky?
Invited me to Martinique. He has a place down there.
Lucky would. Then why does Gloria need $500?
You're very new at this.
I'm desperate.
And on the Jeffersons, it's Judgment Day for George.
Please let me into the kingdom.
Thank you.
out there, our Earth, Wind...
How many of you out there are Earth, Wind, and Fire fans? A few years ago, I was on tour with Earth, Wind, and Fire. I designed some illusions for their show, and an amazing thing kept taking place. They have so many fans that they've got to keep their room numbers a major secret. Yet after each performance, they would return to their rooms only to find a mob of fans who'd somehow discovered their secret room numbers. Well, this would happen night after night, and I couldn't figure out how these people knew where they were staying. So I asked the members of the band, and they said it must be ESP. Well, I used some ESP. And a girl showed up in my room. She wanted to know where they were staying. Well, ever since then, I've been fascinated with how a fan can somehow, by their sheer intuition, discover a secret room number. And I'd like to try to recreate that experience, or part of it anyway. But I'm going to need the help of someone from the... Would you mind helping me out? Give me your hand. Stand up and come up these stairs over here. Give her a big hand as she comes up here. What's your name? Mary? Mary, we haven't met before. We haven't prearranged anything.
No.
You look happy about this. We're going to find three other ladies who I haven't prearranged anything with. And we're going to do it with these three roses. Mary, give me your hand. Step right over here. Face your back to those folks. Your back, there you go. Mm-hmm. And take this rose in your hand. When I ask you to, I'm going to need you to throw that rose over your shoulder into this section of the audience. If it comes close to you, catch it. Okay? If a guy catches it, pass it to the nearest lady. Go ahead, throw it over your shoulder. Just pass it to her and say, this bud's for you. Come over here. Face your back to these folks. You're right in the center there. In fact, let's face center. There you go. Perfect. Now, throw it in that direction. View of the Dodgers? That's quite an arm you got there. Now, come over here and face your back to these folks over here. Go ahead. Now throw it in that direction. You just speared a cameraman. Come over here. You can stand right over here. The first lady, where are you? Raise your hand. There you are. You don't know my room number, do you?
No.
No? No. You had to think about it? The second lady, where are you? Oh, there you are. There you are. Now, you don't know my room number, do you?
No, I don't.
No? And the third lady, you don't know my room number, do you?
No.
Mary?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know my room number?
No, don't think so.
Do you want to know my... You don't have to answer that. We're going to try a little experiment with these four ladies and my room key. This is my room key. I'm going to take it and place it in this champagne glass and hang the champagne glass with the key in it above our heads so we can all keep an eye on it. Now, we're going to need to form a three-digit number because my room number is a three-digit number. The first lady, we haven't prearranged anything.
No.
No. Pick any number between 0 and 9.
4.
4? Take this pen. Write a big 4 right over there. That's good. That's good.
Big 4.
It's a big 4. The second lady, where are you? We haven't set this up. We haven't prearranged anything, have we?
No, we haven't.
No. Pick any number between 0 and 9.
7. 7?
Okay, take this pen. Write a big 7 right there.
Bigger?
That's good, that's good.
One more.
I've been to Europe. The third lady, where are you? There you are. We haven't met before. We haven't prearranged anything, have we?
No.
Pick any number between 0 and 9.
3.
3, fine. Take this pen and write a big 3 right over there. I used to date a 3. She dumped me. The first lady picked a 4. The second lady picked a 7. And the third lady picked a 3, forming room 4, 7, 3. Now, if the number that these three ladies selected matches the number on the back of this key, well, that would be a miracle. Can you see it? For the people
Yeah, read the number printed on the back of that key.
473.
473. How about that? You did it. I think you forgot to return something to me. Give her another hand. She's a little
too. And now, a new kind of magic from the Jolly Green Giant.
Howdy, Sprout. You want some cheese?
The Giant does. But which one?
Well, he makes a brand new cheese sauce.
Brand new?
Yep. Now his good broccoli and cauliflower come with a new white cheddar cheese sauce.
Great. I'll take white cheddar.
Of course, he still makes his golden cheese sauce, too. Now his broccoli and cauliflower come in two kinds of cheese sauce.
Two cheese sauces sure take a lot of cheeses.
Green Giant.
There's a tiger whose life is filled with dangers, protecting the secret formula from strangers.
'Cause the formula makes Kellogg's sugar frosted flake cereal
a delicious part of this nutritious breakfast.
And the secret taste of frosted flakes makes Tony say,
"They're great!"
Tony, that was a close call.
Guess this secret agent stuff can be hairy business.
Coming up, the illusion of a century, as David Copperfield attempts to make the Statue of Liberty disappear.
Monday at Archie Bunker's place on its new night, Barney tries video dating.
The world ain't ready.
And on foot in the door.
I took a spill in the hall and fell on my donut.
When Jonah exaggerates his accident to keep his kids from going away, will he get caught with his pants down? Then Mel gets his dream car, but when it vanishes, will he blame Alice?
Desperate women do desperate things.
Then will illness spoil Anne's trip to Paris one day at a time?
Take this pill or I will kill you.
Four great comedies, Monday.
This is CBS.
I want to show you my very first trick. I started magic early. Well, not that early. The real reason I made this rattle up here is to tell you a story. It's the story of a friend of mine, a magician. And also, it's the story of Emily, who devoted her life to raising other people's children. As a young bride, she was told she could never have children, and shortly after that, she became a widow. Emily decided to take a job, caring for a little girl who had no mother. The little girl's name was Sam. Sarah like her own child. But when Sarah's father remarried, Emily knew she wasn't needed anymore, and she missed Sarah very much. Then came a little boy named Don.
Thank you.
Donnie and his parents had to move, and once again, Emily was separated from people she cared for. After Donnie, she gave her magical care to child after child. Her book of memories, once empty, filled through the years. Let's see. There was Sarah and Donnie and Joey and Paula, Kevin, and oh yes, Tommy. Tommy was entrusted to Emily. His parents had been called back to Europe during the war. As months passed, Emily lost contact with Tommy's parents. They stopped sending money for Tommy's care. And Emily turned to running errands and doing chores to support them both. Tommy's parents, 8 years had passed. Emily didn't mind the work. It was the first time in her life she had a child all to herself. And she enjoyed the feeling for as long as it would last. Until one day, a note arrived. Returning, and they wanted their son back. Where were they when Emily worried about his measles and pneumonia? Where were they when Emily got on her knees and prayed to God to take her life instead of Tommy's? Well, Tommy was returned to his real parents. Parents wanted younger people to take care of their children. Eventually, Emily couldn't find a job. No one would hire her to do what she loved most, taking care of children. That's when she met my friend, the magician. She told him about her life, showed him her picture album, and shortly after that, received an invitation for an evening at the home of my friend. Surprise for you.
A surprise? Oh, this is exciting.
Tommy.
Little Donnie. He's afraid of the lightning.
I can can't believe it after all these years. Emily, I bet you're still taking care of children.
Oh, my, what a big boy you are. I can't get over it.
Emily, this is Paula, and Kevin, and Joey. We've got one more surprise for you. You didn't recognize me before, did you? I'm Tommy.
Why? I can't speak. I'm so very, very happy. You did all this for my dear children.
We've got one more surprise for you.